Hey, welcome back, Chris Garlock, back with Michael Redmond for game 14 in our series of AlphaGo versus the world. Michael, we're coming to sort of the end of the first batch of players, I think. We'll be
moving. No way you could say that. Pretty soon in this series, we're going to have some heavyweight players who are world famous and world champions and that kind of thing. But Yang Zaiming is a young player. He was born in 1997, so he's about 20 at the time of this game. And he was promoted to 6-dan later. And he was a 3-dan at the time of this playing.
Okay, and take a look.
It's really interesting, the game, to me, because I was researching his games about that time. And you might recall in game number 8, we had a player called Han Yuzhao playing against AlphaGo. That was in game number 8. And there was a game between these two players, Yang Zaiming and Han Yuzhao.
Wow.
And they played the same opening that we're going to see in this game. And so Yang Zaiming is trying it against AlphaGo. In the game he played against Han Yuzhao, he won by 1.5 points. So he had a good experience with this opening. So he's going to try something he's maybe feeling a bit confident about.
Yeah, I'm going to say maybe it's not going to work out the same way. Just a guess. Oh,
yes. So the human player is white and plays this pincer. Again, this is a point where nowadays people would not be playing this pincer because black gets to press.
Right.
So you see people playing the diagonal move or something like that. This move or this move. It's, some people will even kick and jump here. And so white has these choices nowadays. Pincering has become a bit unusual because black is supposed to be perfectly okay when black presses like this. You can see white crawls 3 times. So this is something that Yang Zaiming had tried out in an earlier game. And he thought he liked it. And it looks like something I might try myself. It looks like if white can handle this weak group on the left side, it's going to be perfectly okay for white because white has territories on both sides. It all depends on what happens in this fight here. And in the game white played here, and he's still playing the sequence that he played against Han Yuzhao in the previous game. But actually, this is a point where this would have been the better shape, and it may arguably the better move. If white plays this way, then it will be relatively easy for white to live. White can play like this to make a defect in black's outside wall. And then white can just cut here with a lot of forcing moves from inside, like white obviously has this forcing move or a forcing move here. And in this case, white can start with the attachment. Basically, white will have enough room. Also, white can force with a move like this. So white will have enough room to make a living shape. And also white has cut at a vital point in black's wall, setting up a possible wedge here or maybe the cut here. This is going to be an even fight. It's about even, I would say. Close enough to even that I would not notice any difference anyway. Like AlphaGo probably thinks that black has a very slight advantage. It would be 1 or 2 points if we put a point score to it.
Okay.
It's nothing that I would be noticing at this point of the game. But it would have been better for white to play this way. White plays here. Black plays the double hane. This is a very good move. It was also played by Han Yuzhao in the game that he played Yang Zaiming. So it's a natural shape move that anyone would play. And when black plays this move, it's going to be difficult for white to break out into the center. So white counterattacks with this and extends. And white can capture the cutting stone. So the fact that white has captured the cutting stone, that was a success for white. But also you might notice that it's a false eye. Capturing
it
that
sure is.
False eye. And so it's going to be a fight. It's interesting that the nature of this fight has changed a lot. Because black has, having played this move, black has a very strong shape on this side. So this black group is, for the time being, it's not taking part in this fight. It's already safe. And so that black group is finished settled already, and the fight is going to be limited to this white group, which has a false eye there, and this black group, which is white right next to it. And it's not a big difference. Like, this is, at this point, I would not know who is ahead. And the fact that a fairly strong player is playing with black for this position for the second time, and he doesn't feel bad about it. So that sort of demonstrates the fact that this is a very close position. Actually, the human is white. Did I say the human was black there? If I did, then ignore it.
Okay.
So white played here. This was white's mistake. White should have played
here. Yeah.
And nice black, shape. Living on the side is going to be painful for black if black tries to do that. Black will probably try to move out into the center, after which now white can play this move as a forcing move, threatening to cut black with white's threatening to cut black here. So black has to answer that. And in this fight, white is taking territory in the lower left corner.
Nice.
And it's very important that white is just sort of ignoring this stone, because capturing that one stone will not be enough to give black two eyes. So it's not a big deal. It's not something that white should be worried about. Even if white, for instance, just answers it like that. It's not two eyes for black. And this exchange actually consolidates white's corner territory. So it's not something that white should be worried about. And white is out in the center. So if white had played this way, it still would have been a fairly close game. I think that AlphaGo or a computer program would be giving black an advantage, maybe up to 60%. But it would still be a position where I would not really be noticing. I would maybe have a feeling that it was okay for black, but I would not really be noticing it. So I think really white's mistake was in being too attached to this one stone when white played here. And white saved this stone in a position where white should have been taking advantage, taking the initiative a little bit by attacking from above. So in this position, now black is starting to attack in the center. And actually, at the time, it was the moves after this where I was noticing how AlphaGo was handling it. But already at this point, AlphaGo, I mean KataGo, which is the program I use when I'm having a different Komi. These games are at 6.5 Komi, so they don't work with some of the AI. So I use KataGo and I adjust the Komi for it. KataGo is already giving black a 70%, more than 70% winning.
Oh, wow, that much.
It's a bit difficult for me to see, really, but in the following moves, you're going to see AlphaGo playing in a way that seems just a little bit unorthodox, but suddenly taking control of the lower side. And this was all possible because of the strong group that black had on the other side. This group was so strong, you can notice that black has not added any stones to it.
No.
After playing this move. Once black has played this move, it is established as a strong group. The fact that black did not have to add stones to that made it that much easier for black to build this magnificent area on the lower side. And this game, it's just very one-sided after this, but the way AlphaGo handles it is going to be interesting. So I will be going into that in the book, but I think I should stop here for this video.
Yeah, and again, and I'm just struck, and I have to say, I love these you know, really focused. And I remember when we did this series years ago, you know, with human games, the same thing, that by stripping it down to the essentials, you know, which is, of course, one of, I think, your great strengths, the ability to sort of cut right to the main point. But when you match that with the beauty of AlphaGo, you know, it really, because I'll be honest, you know, oftentimes in those AlphaGo games, you know, it can get so complicated, and as you delight and oh, you think the game is over. No, you know, there's going to be some more stuff going on. And so seeing how effortlessly, easily,
AlphaGo,
seemingly, thank you, effortlessly, AlphaGo just sort of takes control. And these are good players. They're not really doing anything terribly wrong.
They are good players. There are players who I who would, you know, they're the top players in the world. They're players that I respect. And so it's very entertaining to see this. It's also a learning experience because they're not really playing serious mistakes. They're playing moves that should work to a certain extent. And in this case, White was playing a sequence that actually worked in a previous game against the top pro. So he was confident with it. And seeing how AlphaGo handled that and sort of nullified the effect of White's moves was very illuminating.
So I hope that in your when you do the more detailed analysis for the book, I'd be fascinated to see how the human version of this diverged from the version against AlphaGo. That would be kind of fun to take a look at. That's
very good.
Yeah. All right, Michael, as always, wonderful. And just a little reminder, folks, when we pick up with the next game, we're going to be getting into some other players. I think we're coming up into the Nine Dons decided to take a whack at it, right?
And world champions caught on to the fact that something special was happening. And so we're going to see a lot of very special players coming on.
All right. So stay tuned for that. We'll see you all next game. Thanks so much for watching.